Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the different types of synapses. A synapse is a site where two cells communicate with each other. Notice I used the word cell and not neuron. That's intentional, though we classically think of synapses occurring between two neurons, and that is certainly the most popular type of synapse in the body, it's not the only kind. Neurons have to communicate with other neurons, yes, but they also need to talk to other cells. For a limb movement to happen, a neuron needs to send a signal to the muscle fibers of a skeletal muscle for them to contract. This is also a synapse, a neuromuscular synapse, and the junction between the two is the neuromuscular junction. If you have studied about the neuromuscular junction, you'll find learning about neuronal synapses easier than if you haven't. They're similar, definitely not the same, and I'll talk about some of their differences in a little bit. If you haven't studied it yet, no worries, there's no strict order to these things, but I would recommend that while you're studying neuronal synapses, you also study about the neuromuscular junction. Muscles aren't the only organs with effector cells in the body. There are also glands. Neurons can stimulate glands to increase secretion. That communication happens at a neuroglandular synapse. In some synapses, neurons aren't involved at all. Neurons aren't the only excitable cells. Muscles are also excitable. Cardiac muscle cells, some smooth muscle cells, are excitable and also have synapses, allowing them to communicate with each other. Even immunological cells form synapses, like between antigen-presenting cells and T lymphocytes. These are called immunological synapses, and we'll deal with those in immunology. Let's put them aside. But what about the rest? They're different from synapses like the neuromuscular junction because these use gap junctions to communicate. They're known as electrical synapses. Gap junctions that we see in these electrical synapses are channels that connect the two cells. Let's turn these clockwise. Now, each gap junction is made up of proteins called connexons. There are lots of connexons that form a gap junction. Let's magnify one of them. Each cell contributes to half of each channel, forming hemichannels. If you put them together, you get one complete channel. The structures that make up the connexons are called connexins, with an I. The most common connexin in mammals is connexin 36. Each connexon is a hexamer of connexins, so they have six of these units forming a pore in the center. This pore is how the two cells can communicate. It's the gap in the junction. They form a low-resistance, high-conductance bridge between the cells so that electrical signals can move from one cell to the next in the form of ion currents. These aren't specific to any particular ion. They're simple in that they just let the ions and even some small organic molecules to move between the cells. The distance between the cells is very small, it's just about 4 nanometers. And these gap junctions, they allow fast communication. You'll realize why that's important when you think about the locations of these kinds of synapses. The heart. The contractile cells of the heart are connected by gap junctions. Ion currents can rapidly move between all the cells, ensuring they contract together as a syncytium. Thus, all the contractile cells of the ventricles contract together to pump blood out through those great vessels. That kind of fast communication is thanks to these gap junctions. Gap junctions can allow bidirectional movement of currents, though there are some kinds of electrical synapses that only allow current to move in a single direction. These are known as rectifying synapses. However, most electrical synapses are bidirectional. We can see these types of electrical synapses in neurons as well, but the other type, that's the chemical synapse, is more complex and is more common. This is what the neuromuscular junction and most neuronal synapses are, chemical synapses. They use a chemical for communication. That chemical is a neurotransmitter. Neurons communicate using electrical signals in the form of action potentials. This is how these signals travel along axons. The action potentials, however, cannot jump from one neuron to the next at a chemical synapse. They travel along the axons, reach the axon terminal, but from here a neurotransmitter needs to be released, which can then bind to a receptor on the other neuron, changing its potential. That potential change may or may not result in an action potential, but if it does, it'll get propagated down that neuron as well. So there are electrical signals before and after the synapse, but in between, we need that chemical neurotransmitter. Thus, there are three functional parts to a chemical synapse. The neuron that does the talking is the presynaptic neuron. The neuron that does the listening is the postsynaptic neuron, and the space between them is the synaptic cleft. That cleft is around 20 to 30 nanometers wide, much bigger than with an electrical synapse. The number of steps involved here are obviously more, so it takes time. There's a delay in communication between the pre- and postsynaptic neuron. This is known as a synaptic delay, and this is something you don't see with an electrical synapse since they are fast. But chemical synapses have a synaptic delay. Now, which parts of the neuron usually form this synapse? If we look at multipolar neurons, they have a cell body or a soma with two kinds of processes, short dendrites and a long axon. The axon ends in branches called axon terminals, which terminate in little knobs known as terminal buttons or synaptic knobs. These synaptic knobs usually form the presynaptic membrane. We have different structural types of synapses. To make it simpler, we're going to use the schematic neuron, but remember that motor neurons are myelinated and there are multiple axon terminals. This is just a schematic neuron. The presynaptic neuron can make contact with different parts of the postsynaptic neuron, the dendrites, the soma, and the axon. Thus, based on site of contact, there can be axosomatic, axodendritic, or axoaxonic synapses. There are others as well, like dendrodendritic, dendrosomatic, etc. But these three are the most common, and of them, the axodendritic synapse is the most common. If you look at motor neurons, nearly 80 to 95% of the synapses are axodendritic, while just 5 to 20% are with the soma. So axodendritic is the most common based on the site of contact. The axoaxonic synapse is actually a little more complex. You usually see these at modulatory synapses, those that are trying to change what happens at the usual synapse. But the mechanism in all three as chemical synapses is the same. Neurotransmitters are released and they bind to receptors. If you look at these two ends under an electron microscope, we get two kinds of synapses, type 1 and type 2 synapses. Beneath the postsynaptic membrane is a postsynaptic density, which has proteins and receptors. This is an electron-dense region, which is larger in the type 1 synapses when compared to the electron-dense region with active zones in the presynaptic neuron. So type 1 synapses are asymmetric. In type 2, they're thinner, making them more symmetric. Within the presynaptic terminal, neurotransmitters are stored in synaptic vesicles. In the type 1 synapses, these vesicles are round and larger, while in type 2, they are flat or oblong and smaller. The synaptic cleft is wider in the type 1 synapses at around 30 nanometers when compared to 20 nanometers in type 2. The type 1 synapses are usually axodendritic, while the type 2 ones could be any of the three types. Generally, the type 1 synapses are excitatory synapses, while the type 2 are inhibitory. That's one of the main differences between neuronal synapses and the neuromuscular ones. The neuromuscular junction is an excitatory synapse. An action potential from the presynaptic neuron triggers the release of a neurotransmitter, which is always acetylcholine. And after binding to its receptor, it changes the potential of the muscle fiber, eventually causing it to contract. Neuronal synapses, on the other hand, could be excitatory or inhibitory, depending on the receptor the neurotransmitter binds to and the effect it has on the postsynaptic neuron. There's lots of different kinds of neurotransmitters in neuronal synapses, including acetylcholine. There's glutamate, glycine, serotonin, norepinephrine, etc., and they have different kinds of receptors. The neuromuscular junction has a one-to-one relationship, where one muscle fiber is innervated by a single motor neuron. So it has a high safety factor and is more efficient, meaning a single action potential will release enough neurotransmitter to stimulate contraction of the muscle fiber. That's not the case with neurons. Multiple neurons form synapses. On an average, one neuron can form over 2,000 synaptic endings, and around 50 to 100 neurons have to fire together to bring the potential in the postsynaptic neuron high enough to set off an action potential in that neuron. So even though they're similar, there are a lot of differences between these two kinds of synapses. What is common between them is that they are both chemical synapses. Thus, we have electrical synapses and chemical synapses. Some neurons can actually have both when they're called conjoint or mixed synapses. Those are all the different kinds of synapses. In part 2, we'll learn about the steps of synaptic transmission at a chemical synapse, starting with the presynaptic neuron. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.